We have analyzed why it is reasonable to update the weak vector as follows. Okay? We have checked in different kinds of mistakes how the function value, classification function value, changes after the update. Right? And also we have a look at the geometry view of these updates, how we change the direction and length of our new weak vector, and how we adjust the position of our separating hyperplane accordingly so as to correct our mistake. Right? So now that the perception is the typical mistake-driven learning algorithm, we are very curious about the number of mistakes made by perception. Right? So at the beginning, we introduced two theorems which describe the behaviors of perception. Right? What are the two theorems?
There's a convergence theorem and cycle theorem, cycles theorem.
Yeah, great. So we introduce perceptions behaviors in two different cases, right? Namely, two types of data. So first, when the data is linearly separable, then what happens to our perception? It converges, right? It will always make some number of mistakes, make a finite number of mistakes, and then converges. With that being said, if you keep running perception finally, it will not make any mistakes. So it will not update the model weak vectors anymore. Right? This is called convergent theory. And in the second case, we talk about perception's behavior when the data is not linear separable, right? Then when data is not linear separable, what's the behavior of perception? Yeah, it cyclically updates the weak vectors, right? Assume you're going into a set of distinct weak vectors, then perception, if you do not intend to stop perception, it just cyclically switch to different or distinct weak vectors. So that's the two behaviors for perception algorithm, and you should keep in mind. And then we focus on the ideal case where the data is linear separable. So we have the so-called mystic bound theory for the perception, right? So as we can see, the convergence theorem is a straightforward conclusion for the mystic bound theorem, right? So now let us briefly review what is mystic bound theory and what does it tell us. So for mystic bound theorem, we have to make two assumptions, right? What are the two assumptions? Don't look at the slides.
Test the memory.
An idea?
The features are bounded.
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, the battery is dead. I have to switch. So what's the first assumption? So the first assumption is that we assume the length of input vectors is limited, right? It has an upper bound. We call it R, right? The length is represented by the norm of input vectors, right? So this is quite reasonable because we usually do not assume we have an infinite number of features. We also do not assume our feature value could be infinite, right? With that being said, we can always find out such kind of upper bound R, right? So how can we identify AR? We mentioned that in the last lecture, right? Yeah, we can look at the point, the data point which is farthest from the origin, right? And then we use the distance between the origin and this farthest point to calculate R, right? So that's the norm for the corresponding input vector, which is the maximum norm of input vectors. So this is about first assumption. So what is the second assumption?
The data has to be linearly separable.
Yes. That's the key assumption, right? If your data is not linear separable, we cannot say anything about perceptions, behaviors, right? Except the second updating behaviors, right? So our second assumption is that our data can be linearly separable. So there must exist a hyperplane which can well separate the positive examples from negative examples. So then there must exist such hyperplane, right? And we can denote its margin by gamma. So remind, let us recall what is the definition for margin. What is that?
The smallest possible distance between your hyperplane and the closest point.
Yes. That's the minimum distance between all the points and the hyperplane, right? And assume our hyperplane, separating hyperplane, is determined by a union with vector u, then we can immediately derive the following inequalities, right? So for any input example xi and its corresponding label yi, we have yi times u transpose xi is more less than gamma. I will have to show how can we derive this inequalities, right? And how can we calculate the distance between any point and the hyperplane, say it is determined by lead vector w, right? So what's the distance? How can we calculate the distance between any point x0 and this hyperplane? What's the formula?
Y0 times x0 transpose w
divided by norm of w. We have introduced at least two methods to derive this formula, right? So you should practice after lectures and keep it in your memory. So given the two assumptions, the limited maximum length of the input vectors and the separability, we can derive that our perception will make at most r over gamma squared mistakes, right? And then we briefly explained in some geometry view, right? Suppose these are the positive examples, these are negative examples. So first, to derive such a bound for the number of mistakes. Mm-hmm.
In this formula, do you not also need to divide by the number of x0 for the distance?
No, it's just divided by the norm of the weak vector. Okay. Nothing to do with norm of x0.
Okay.
You can check that. You can try to derive that. So to find out some upper bound of number of mistakes made by perception in learning a linear classifier which can separate the data here, so what should we figure out first? R, right? The maximum number of the maximum length of input vectors. How can we identify? We'll look at the farthest data point from the origin, right? And use the distance as R, right? So, as we mentioned, if we draw a ball or sphere using this R as radius, then this ball will contain all of the input vectors of data points, right? And because this data is obviously linear separable, so there must be some hyperplane which can perfectly separate positive examples from negative examples. And then we can use the corresponding margin with this upper bound R to derive the bound for the number of mistakes made by perception, right? Which is R squared or gamma squared. And we have also discussed some subtle difference between the bound of the mistake number and actual mistake number, right? So because this data is linear separable, so there will be many, many hyperplanes. Each hyperplane can well separate positive examples from negative examples. So for different hyperplanes, there will be a set of distinct margin gamma, right? So actually, we can construct a lot of bounds for the number of mistakes, right? But those bounds are not necessarily equal to the actual number of mistakes made by perception. Right? So be aware of the difference. And actually, another thing you should be aware that even if I use the margin for this particular hyperplane to construct our bound for mistake number. It does not necessarily mean if I train my linear classifier using perception, perception will finally converge to the exact same hyperplane. It will converge to a totally different hyperplane, see, like this, which can also separate data well. This is not guaranteed. So this bound is just some theoretical estimation about the upper bound of the number of mistakes. And we use this upper bound to analyze the properties of our perception algorithm. Whether this perception algorithm in learning some specific target function is efficient, right, in reducing the number of mistakes. So can anyone recall the brief ideas to prove this bound? We use three steps, right? And in the first two steps, we prove two inequalities. Both inequalities contain a term which include the number of mistakes. And in the third step, we combine the two inequalities by Cauchy's Gauss inequality, right? And finally we derive a new inequality. And both sides of this inequality contains number of mistakes. And finally we can derive the upper bound of number of mistakes. So this is a sketch for the proof. And the proof for first and second steps are all based on induction method. So I hope you can review the details about this proof after the lecture. And you should be able to prove that. And you should be able to capture the idea to derive such kind of a general bound, because this kind of tricks, say deriving some loose upper bounds and connecting those inequalities together, are widely used in computational learning theory, not only for analyzing perception. Any question about this? Okay, great. Now let us look at some concrete example. And actually, at the end of last lecture, we stopped at half in analyzing perception learning for some specific function, right? So we have to restart. So let us look at if we want to use perception to learn a disjunction of n variables or n attributes, how can we obtain a meaningful bound of number of mistakes? So first, let us be clear, what do we mean by using perception to learn a disjunction of n variables? Remember, disjunction is actually a Bloom function, but our perception is looking for linear classifiers. So then what do we mean by using perception to learn a Bloom function? Yeah, exactly, right? So more specifically, assume our target function is simply the disjunction from say fx1 to xn. It's simply a disjunction from x1 to xn, right? So what's the meaning for an equivalent classifier to this disjunction? We need to first create a data set, right? So what are the input vectors for this data set? That is all the possible inputs for this disjunction. So say we have an x1, x2, xn, and the function value f, right? So each different configuration of x1 to xn corresponds to one possible input vector to this function, right? And which also corresponds to one input vector in our constructed set D. Then what are the labels for those input vectors? Indeed. Well, the labels for any input vector belongs to D is determined by the disjunction value, right? So suppose we have a set of data points. Then who determines the label? The disjunction function value, right? If the disjunction function value for this set of data points are 1, then what's the label?
1.
Yeah, positive, right? And if the disjunction value for this set of inputs are 0, then what's the label?
-1.
Yeah, -1 or negative, whatever, right? So an equivalent linear classifier for this to this disjunction means that the linear classifier can well separate the positive and negative examples in this data set, right? With that being said, we can use our classification result to determine the corresponding disjunction for the input, right? That's why we call it equivalent. So now we know what do we mean by learn a disjunction of n variables using perception. And now, to find out a meaningful bound of number mistake, what should we figure out according to our mistake bound theory?
R and gamma.
Yeah, R and gamma, right? Because our bound is determined by two values, right? The first value is the maximum length of input vectors, and the second value is the margin for some separating hyperplane, right? So let us first look at some non-trivial gamma. So to find out the margin, namely the gamma, for some separating hyperplane, what should we do first? We should first find out such a linear classifier, right? And given this linear classifier, we can calculate the margin, right? Otherwise, how do you calculate the margin? So then the question becomes, how can we find out a hyperplane which can separate this data? How can we do that? We actually have discussed this in previous lectures.
So if one of the inputs is 1, the output is 1.
Yeah. We need to check. We need to check in what kind of situations disjunction is 1, and in what kind of situations disjunction is 0, right? And then we try to use some linear inequality to determine the disjunction value.
So if the sum is greater than or equal to 1.
Yeah, exactly, right? So we can look at the summation, right? Because only when all x1 to xn are zeros, the function value is 0, right? And as long as at least one variable is 1, the function value will be 1, right? If there are two variables, the function value will be 1. If all of the variables are 1, the function value will be 1, right? So we can use a linear inequality to describe this kind of conditions or situations, right? This linear inequality is summation from x1 to xn, right? So the summation from x1 to xn is no less than 1 if and only if the disjunction is 1. We can check, right? So if the summation is 0, what happens? Yeah, the function value will be 0, right? So now, from this linear inequality, how can we obtain an equivalent linear classifier to this disjunction?
Just bring one to the other
side. Yeah, it's very simple, right? Remember, the linear classifier is determined by some linear classification function, right? So we have already got this linear inequality, right? So we simply move one from right-hand side to the left-hand side. Then we got our classification function, right? Which is x1 plus x2 plus xn minus 1, right? This is our classification function. And we can check, right? If our classification function is no less than 0, what does that mean? It means this inequality holds, right? And what does it mean if this inequality holds?
It means 1.
Yeah, the disjunction is 1, right? And simultaneously, if the classification function value is no less than 0, then what's our prediction result? Positive, right? So positive is consistent with disjunction value 1, right? So if this classification function value is below 0, what's our classification result? Minus 1, right? Negative. And what is the disjunction value? 0, right? This is a, if it is less than 0, then all of x1, x2, x1 are 0, right? So the disjunction value is 0. So the negative label is consistent with disjunction 0, right? So obviously, this linear classifier is equivalent to our disjunction function, right? And now, can we use the margin for this linear classifier to get our bound for number of mistakes in the section?
No. Margin is 0.
Yeah. We need first check, right? We need to compute the margin. Okay. We'll look at what is the margin for this linear classifier. So first, what is the hyperplan for this linear classifier? Remember, what decides a what determines a hyperplan? What determines a separate hyperplan with respect to the linear classifier? Yeah, the weights, and more specifically, it can be described by an equality, right? That is the classification function value is 0, right? So the separating hyperplane can be written as, or can be described by the equality that the classification function value is 0, right? And now we want to calculate the margin for this hyperplane. With that being said, we need to calculate the minimum distance between all possible input vectors and this margin, right? So we can take a look at the definition of margin, right? So margin is minimum distance across all possible data points, right? And we evaluate distance between each data point and the hyperplane H, right? So what's this distance? Suppose this hyperplane H is determined by the weak vector W. We can use the formula, right? This one is W transpose XI times W, right? And times YI, right? This is the distance definition. So now, question, what is W here? What is W here? Yeah, we can take a look at a classification function, right? So W will be 1, 1, 1. The first elements are all 1, right? Because this is our classification function. And then we append the bias term minus 1. Right? This is our weak vector. So now the problem becomes, what's the minimum value for the numerator in the distance calculation, right? So what's the minimum value?
Zero,
right? Why the minimum distance? Why the minimum numerical value is 0?
When one of the value is 1.
Yeah, we can look at, right? We can check many data points. We'll see some data points directly lie on this hyperplane. Why? We can take a look. If we set any one of variable is 1, right? And all the remaining variables to be 0. And what's the corresponding classification function value? Namely this one. What's the classification function value? You can check, right? It's 0, right? With that being said, the distance is 0, right? So it means this data point strictly directly lies on the hyperplane. So the margin, remember, the margin is the minimum distance. So if there is some data point directly lies on the hyperplane, the margin will be 0.
Can you say just that y I will be all
Yes, yes, yeah, you're right, right? So W transpose Xi, remember, what's W transpose Xi? It's directly the classification function value, right? So Y is either 1 or minus 1, right? So the distance is 0 if and only if the classification function value is 0, right? So now we can say, if we use this hyperplane, although it is equivalent to our n-variable disjunction, but the margin is 0, then when we use this zero margin to obtain an upper bound of number of mistakes, what is our upper bound? Infinity, right? And there's nothing wrong to say your perception will make infinite number of mistakes. At most, infinite number of mistakes. Logically, there's nothing wrong here. But this bound is not meaningful, right? Then how can we find out meaningful bound for mistake?
I mean, if we make one mistake, then we recalculate, and then if our hyperplane doesn't lie on the point, then we'll get finite number of mistakes.
Yeah, both of you have mentioned the solution, right? Or in a more detailed way, is that we need to give up this hyperplane, right? We try to find out another hyperplane, which can separate data perfectly as well, but has non-zero margin. We have just mentioned, as long as our data is linearly separable, there will be many, many separating hyperplanes, right? We're not restricted to one specific hyperplane to construct a bound, right? So now, let us think about a new hyperplane which is non-zero margin. And I believe you can find out a lot of such hyperplanes, but for simplicity, I will provide a very simple one. That is, I just replace one by 1/2. And let us check whether this classification function can well predict all the training examples. Right? If it is correct, hyperplane, then let us try to calculate the margin for this classification function and say whether the margin is zero or non-zero. Right? So now let us first look at whether it can correctly predict. So what are the negative examples? Yeah, there's only one negative example, right? All zero, right? So for this negative example, what's the classification function value?
One minus 1/2,
right? So it is less than zero, and our prediction will be negative, and disjunction is zero. So it's correct, right? So what are the positive examples?
Any variable.
Yeah. As long as at least one variable is non-zero, then it is positive example, right? So when there is only one non-zero in x1, x2 to xn, what is the classification function value?
1/2,
right? And obviously, our prediction will be positive, and it is correct, right? When there are more than one non-zeros in x1 to xn, what is the classification function value? It will be bigger than 1/2, right? Right? It's very obvious, right? Because you have two ones, and your others are zeros minus 1/2, it's bigger than 1/2, right? And if you have even more non-zeros, then your classification function value even increases, right? So now we can say, for all positive examples, our classification function value is positive. Our prediction is correct, right? And for negative examples, our prediction is correct as well. So this is another equivalent linear classifier to the variable disjunction. Right? And now let us try to calculate the margin for this linear classifier. So again, we look at the definition for margin, right? So which is the minimum distance. Let me directly write down the formula for distance, right? So for minimum distance, xi belongs to our data set, xi transpose w times the label yi, right? Divided by the norm of w. Okay? So question, what is w here?
1. Did we start with the unit vector?
Yeah. W is W is determined by our linear classifier, right? So W is what? The first n elements will be 1, right? And the last element, remember we use the notation simplification tree, right? It is minus 1 over 2. So what is the normal for W? So the norm of W will be very easy, right? Square root of n plus 1 over 4. So the question is, what is the minimum value for numerator? Okay? So what's the minimum value for numerator? Remember, this hyperplane can separate all positive examples from negative examples. With that being said, the prediction for all the data examples are correct. So the numerator will always be positive. Okay? So essentially, the numerator is actually the absolute value for the classification function value. Right? So the problem becomes, what is the minimum of the absolute values of the classification function over each training input? What's the minimum absolute value? Yeah, we have just checked, right? So when you use negative examples, the classification function is minus 1 over 2. The absolute value is 1 over 2, right? So when there is only one zeros in input vectors, in the input vector, then the classification function is 1 over 2, right? When there are more than one non-zeros, the function value is greater than 1 over 2. So what's the minimum absolute value? 1 over 2, right? So now we can obtain our margin, right? So the minimum numerator is 1 over 2, right? And the norm of the weight vector is what? Square root plus 1, right? And obviously, we can move these two in the denominator, right? Then we got, and into the square root, we have 1 over 4 and plus 1. So we have identified the margin, a non-zero margin for separating hyperplane. So next, we should figure out what is R, right? The upper bound for the length of input vectors. What is R? Remember, our input vectors are all binary input vectors. Now what is the maximum length of the input vectors? N? Yeah, there's some subtle difference you should be aware. Remember, when we talk about mistake bound theorem, the results are based on the location simplification tree. Yeah, so we have augmented, we have folded the bias term in our weight vector, right? At the same time, we augment our input vector by a constant feature, right? So now the input vectors are all n plus 1 dimensional. So what is the maximum length of the input vectors?
N plus 1.
The farthest point from the origin will be a full 1, right? And because it is n plus 1 dimension, so R will be square root of n plus 1, right? And the question about this? It's very simple. So now with R and gamma, we can obtain our bound of number of mistakes, right? So what's the bound of number of mistakes? R over gamma square, right? Which is square root of n plus 1 divided by 1 over 4 n plus 1 pip square, which is n plus 1 times 4 n plus 1 proportional to n squared, right? So now from this result, what can we conclude about the subject number? What can we conclude? Yeah, it is a mistake bound algorithm, right? Remember the definition for mistake bound algorithm. The maximum number of mistakes is polynomial to the number of input variables or input dimensionality. So it's called mistake bound algorithm, right? So if you use perception to learn a disjunction of n variables, the perception is guaranteed to be a mistake bound algorithm. It is very efficient in reducing number of mistakes, right? So now let us talk about the second example. Suppose our target function is not n disjunction. It's a small k disjunction all of n zeros. K could be very small, and n could be very large. Say n could be millions, and k could be 4 or 5. Then what's the, if we use the perception to learn such a small k disjunction, what's the bound of number of mistakes? We can follow this idea, right? Derive it again. So suppose our target function is simply k disjunction, say the disjunction between the first k variables. And now if we want to use perceptual to learn an equivalent linear classifier, we want to identify the bound for the number of mistakes, right? So again, to identify the bound of mistakes, we should figure out R and gamma, right? So what is R?
The same. Always the same.
What is R? Our input space does not change, right? So we still have n input variables. Although our target function now becomes a k disjunction rather than n disjunction. So what is R? Remember, R is only determined by the input space, right? Yeah, so R is still square root of n plus 1, right? It doesn't change. So now we need to identify a margin for some separating hyperplane, right? Now let's try to find out such a hyperplane, separating hyperplane. So again, how can we find out such a hyperplane, separating hyperplane? We can look at the situations when the k disjunction is 1 and when the k disjunction is 0, right? So when the k disjunction is 1, right? When the k disjunction is 1? From target function, we know that all first k variables are 0. And for the remaining variables, xk plus 1 to xn, you can take arbitrary values, right? Nothing to do with the function value. Then the function value must be 0, right? So now, question, how many negative examples right now? Is there only one negative example? No, right? There could be many, many negative examples, right? It's different from the n disjunction case. N disjunction case, there is only one negative example, but for k disjunction case, remember when we fix x1, x2 to xk to be 0, we can take arbitrary values for xk plus 1 to xn, right? Then the disjunction is still 0. So there could be many, many negative examples. So when the disjunction, the k disjunction is 1,
something in the first k features is 1.
Yeah, at least one variable in the first k variables are 1. Then arbitrary values for is xk plus 1 to xk, then the f is 1, right? Say x1 being 1, and arbitrary value. Or x1, x2 being 1, blah, blah. Right? So now how can we convert this disjunction into a linear classifier? We follow the same recipe, right? Follow the same recipe. We first use a linear inequality to determine the k disjunction level, right? What is this linear inequality? Can we still check the summation from x1 to xn?
Up to xk is enough.
Not feasible, right? Because the values from xk plus 1 to xk xn have nothing to do with function value, right? So what's the summation should we check? We only need to check the summation from x1 to sk, right? And when the disjunction is 1? Yeah, greater than or equal to 1, right? So we immediately obtain an equilinear classifier, right? We just move 1 from right hand side to left hand side, we got our first separating hyperplane to be at t minus 1 equal to 0, right? And obviously, this is an equivalent linear pacifier. So now, what's the margin for this hyperplane? What's the margin for this hyperplane? Still 0, right? Because we find a lot of input data points which strictly lie, or which directly lie on this hyperplane, right? Can you give an example? Can you give an example which directly lie on the hyperplane? Yeah, you can. There are so many such kind of data points, right? So for example, you can set x1 to be 1, right? x2 to be to xk to be 0, right? And you can take arbitrary values for xk plus 1 to xn, right? And what is the classification function value? 0, right? With that being said, it lies on the hyperplane. So obviously, we cannot use this hyperplane to construct our bound, right? It is infinity again. Then what's our solution? Yeah, we need to switch to another separating hyperplane, right? And can you work out some alternative hyperplane? Yeah, we can try. Now let us take a look. Just following the previous example, we just change 1 over 2, and say whether this hyperplane can separate the data well, and whether its margin is non-zero, right? So first, we need to check the correctness of this hyperplane, right? So what are the negative examples? What are the negative examples? Yeah, we fix x1, 2, xk to be all 0, right? And we can use arbitrary values for xk plus 1 to xn, right? And then by given those set of negative examples, what are their corresponding classification function value? Remember, this is a classification function value, right? So what is classification function value? Minus 1 over 2, right? So our prediction will be negative, right? And the k disjunction will be 0, right? So it's correct. So now, what are the positive examples? Yeah, as long as we have at least one variables, and the first key variables are 1, then our disjunction will be 1, right? And our label will be positive. Say x1 is 1, the other is 0, and arbitrary value for xk plus 1 to xn, then what is the classification function value? 1 over 2, right? So it's positive, and our prediction is correct, right? So what if there are more than one non-zeros in the first key variables? Say, 2 ones. Then what will be the classification functionality? Yeah, greater than 1/2, right? Obviously, the more non-zeros, the larger the classification function value, right? They will be all positive, right? So now we have checked all the possible inputs in our data set, and this linear classifier can correctly predict them, all of them, right? So we do not have to worry about the separating capability of this hyperplane. Now we need to calculate the margin, right? So again, we can use this formula to calculate the margin, the minimum distance between all the data points and the hyperplane, right? So according to this formula, what's the weak vector? What's the weak vector for our linear classifier? All ones?
No, with -1/2
in the end.
Remember,
yeah.
the specific form of our
in
Pascal, right? So what is W? The first key elements will be all ones, right? And what are the elements from P plus 1 to n? All zero, right? And that. And finally, we'll append the bias term, which is 1 plus 1 to 2, right? So this is our new weak vector. And what's the norm for this weak vector? That's very easy, right? So the norm of W will be the first k elements are 1, right? So we have k plus the in the middle section all zeros, right? We do not need to calculate that. The last term is 1 over 2, right? K squared. So plus 1 over 4, right? So this is the norm for the vector. And now the question becomes, what is the minimum numerical value, right? In other words, what's the minimum absolute value for the classification over all the data points? What's the minimum value? It's still 1/2, right? We haven't checked. We haven't checked all possible input vectors, right? We say when the examples are negative, the classification function value will always be minus 1 over 2. So the absolute value will be 1 over 2, right? And for all positive examples, the classification function value will be at least 1 over 2, right? So in total, the minimum absolute value for classification function over all the inputs will be 1 over 2, right? So now we obtain our margin, right? What is our margin? Your margin is 1 over 2, right? And the denominator will be root of k plus 1 over 4, right? And we can move 2 from the numerator to the denominator. Now we get 1 over square root 4k plus 1. Right? So this is our margin. Now, as we just discussed, R is still square root of 1 plus 1, right? Because our input space does not change. Then what is our upper bound? What is our upper bound of number of mistakes in the exception? R over gamma squared, right? R is square root of 1 plus 1. And gamma is here, right? 1 over 4k plus 1, right? Gamma k squared. What is it? It simply is 4k plus 1 multiplying 1 plus 1, right? So remember, k is much smaller than, and we can treat it as a constant. So it is proportional to n, right? So now what can we conclude?
Mistake bound because it's polynomial.
Yeah, it is definitely a mistake bound algorithm, right? And even better, right? It is even more efficient than learning the n variable disjunction, right? Because right now it is only proportional to n, right? Not proportional to n squared, right?
Suppose we found a different gamma, and after doing all the square root, we find that it's proportional to something that's not polynomial. That's still not enough to conclude that it's not mistake bound.
No.
But as long as we find one example of a gamma that is mistake bound, then
yeah. Very good point. Very, very good point. Yeah, but at least from this example.
In this example, we knew beforehand which k variables were in disjunction to form our function, right?
Yeah.
So what would be the reason for putting in them in this larger vector space instead of just doing the previous example with now n equals k, right?
Yeah, if n equals k, then we return to our previous example, right?
Right, so why not just cut off those last k plus 1 through n variables and just run the perceptron on only the variables that matter?
Well, actually, you do not know the Hardy function. Perceptive algorithm actually does not know. Actually, does not know the Hardy function, right?
Okay.
We know the Hardy function. We just want to bound number of mistakes. But if you throw this problem to perception, it cannot determine what exactly the key is.
Right.
So now let us try to recall a theorem which we discussed before. We mentioned this particular problem, small k disjunction, learning a small k disjunction out of a large number of variables, say n. And we mentioned that if we insist on using the original concept class, namely the disjunction family, as our hypothesis space, and we want to design a learning algorithm to search over the original concept class, what's the consequence? The consequence is that if you search over the original concept class, namely the disjunction family, no matter how you design your learning algorithm, it is always going to be hard. Right? Can you recall that? And this is kind of a frustrating conclusion, right? And at that time, we discussed a counterintuitive solution, right? So for a normal solution, how can we do that? How can we address that? We reduce the hypothesis space, right? So you can pick up a small subset of the disjunction to search over, right? And in that sense, we might be able to make our algorithm to do more efficient search, but it might sacrifice the accuracy of our learned classifier, right? Of our learned hypothesis, right? We might finally end up with some approximation to the target function. But we mentioned that sometimes when we otherwise expand our hypothesis space to a much larger family, say the linear classifier family, and our computational efficiency can be much more efficient in terms of computational cost. Why linear classifiers are more expensive? Because any disjunction, any M of n rule, any conjunction can have at least one equivalent linear classifier. So linear classifier family is much more flexible and larger than the original concept class, namely the disjunction family, right? So now we can say if we switch to a larger hypothetical space, the computational cost is largely reduced, right? So what's the time complexity for perceptive? Think about it. It's very easy, right? Perception sequentially process each training example, right? So the time complexity will only proportional to the number of processed training examples, right? So it is linear to the number of training examples, or linear to the data set. It is definitely not on the hard, right? And even it is not square to the size of data, right? So it is highly efficient. And also we can, from this analysis, we say perception is also efficient in reducing number of mistakes because it is a mistake-free algorithm. So now we have seen a concrete example. How will we expand our hypothesis space to a much larger family, our computational cost dramatically reduces. So this is kind of amazing. But let me tell you the essence. The essence here is that when we expand our hypothesis space to a larger family, remember, our learning is always a search procedure, right? In the original concept class, say to search for the group functions, the disjunction group functions, our search is essentially a combinatorial search, discrete search, right? And now when we go to a larger family, the linear classifier, then our search becomes continuous search. And usually continuous search is much, much more efficient than the discrete search or combinatorial search. Similar ideas have been applied in optimization field for many years. For example, a typical example is like integer planning. If you do integer planning, your feasible region will be some discrete values in Pythagoras, right? So your search will be a typical combinatorial search. So a commonly used method is to extend your feasible region to be continuous region. Then you can use continuous search, typically like gradient descent. And in that case, it is very common that the computing cost is much more, is reduced much. Yeah, this is a typical example. And this is an explanation why when we expand our hypothesis space, our computational efficiency is dramatically improved. And you can think about after the lecture. So now, regarding the Misty bound theorem about perception, we haven't finished everything. And you need to be able to prove the Misty bound theorem. You should be able to write down the Misty bound. And when you are given some concrete learning example, you should be derive some meaningful bound. So the remaining things about perception is how can we apply perception algorithm in practical applications. And here we'll introduce several variants of perception. So first we'll introduce how can we apply a standard perception in practical dataset, namely in finite dataset. And then we'll introduce a variant of perception called margin perception. Margin perception actually encourages your learned classifier to have larger margin. And we'll explain why we should encourage our linear classifier to have large margin. And finally, we'll discuss when our application is nonlinear separable, then how can we improve the quality and the robustness of our perception prediction. So now let us first look at how can we apply the standard perception in practice. So basically it's very simple. If in our practical applications want to apply standard perception, we usually process the training examples for multiple times. So each pass of this training example is called a epoch. So basically we pass the training example multiple times. So within each epoch, we first random shuffle the data. Then we sequentially process each training example according to the shuffling order, right? And then we update the weak vector if we make mistakes. And after finish one epoch, we reshuffle the data again, and this sequentially process this training example, and again until we finish all the epochs. So remember, when you finish your perception, say in our homework, you have to specify a hyperparameter t, which is the number of epochs you need to process the data, right? And also be aware, we can use this inequality to determine whether we have made a mistake, right? This is very useful when you write a program, right? You do not need to differentiate what kind of mistakes you made, right? You only use one inequality to see whether your current classifier is correct or not, right?
Is it okay to stop early if you make it through the entire data set with no mistakes instead of going through T epochs?
Yeah, of course, you can. But this is a general thing. Yeah. And of course you can do early stopping. Any question about this? It's very simple. So after class you can look at the slides again, right? And you are required to implement this algorithm. And just follow the pseudocode. It's very simple. And now let us look at a variant for perception. It's called margin perception. So to motivate margin perception, let us consider a problem. So as we know, when the data is linearly separable, there could be many hyperplanes which can well separate data. Then there comes a question. How do you choose those hyperplanes? Say we have two hyperplanes, H1 and H2 here, right? And which one do you prefer to use to predict the future of same examples? And which one do you believe to have a better prediction performance?
H1.
Why?
Because of
bigger margins.
Why a bigger margin can give you better performance?
You have more room for error.
What?
You have more room for error. You know, if there's a slight variation in data, it'll be less likely to cause an error or to mispredict the data point.
Yeah. It's kind of a conclusion, not the explanation.
Yeah.
This is kind of a cool intuition because everyone has a very good sense of intuition. We are very good to design machine learning algorithms. Right? So let us first try to compare the two hyperplanes, right? The direct quantity we can compare is the margin, right? So obviously, the margin for each one is much larger than the margin for each two, right? So how does margin associate with our prediction performance on those future unseen examples? How does margin associate with it? Is larger margin will lead to better prediction performance on those future unseen examples?
Doesn't a larger margin give you kind of in this R over gamma form, it end up being a smaller number of mistakes if you have bigger margin? Plug it into that formula again?
Yeah, this is kind of an analytical view, right? But remember, here we're talking about two separate hyperplanes. So at least for training data, the number of mistakes is zero. So we're talking about what we predict the future on same example. So let us think about this problem. So it is very natural to assume our training data and testing data are coming from the same data distribution, right? This is the most commonly used protocol, right? We have some random source, say Nature, come out a set of training examples, and teacher give the labels, and we train a classifier. Then the Nature comes out another set of test examples. We use our classifier to do a prediction and examine the performance, right? So with that being said, what regions or where do our future test example most likely appear? I mean, in the two-dimensional case, which region, which places will our test example most likely or most probably appear?
Next to the other ones? So like a plus will appear next to the pluses and minus will appear to minuses.
Yeah, we can consider, because from the probability point of view, the most likely region that the data points appear will be the high density region, right? The higher your probability density, the more likely your data appear in that region, right? So because training data and testing data are coming from the same data distribution, so the high density region for training data will be the high density region for the test data. So what's the high density region for training data? Here and here, right? Because these two places are how most of the training data occur, right? Appear, right? So we can expect that in our future unseen test examples, where do they most likely appear? Yeah, same region, right? Although they could not be exactly the same as training examples, but it is very possible, it is very probable that they appear at the same region, right? Now let's consider how the margin affect our prediction performance. So the smaller the margin for a linear classifier, the closer of your classification boundary to data points, right? With that being said, the more likely your hyperplane will cross the high density region. So what's the consequence if your hyperplane crosses the high density region? What's the consequence?
You get a wrong prediction.
You would have some oscillation, right? Many test examples with the same label will oscillate across the boundary of the classification, right? So with that being said, there could be many examples here. There could also be many examples around here, right? So for H2, if many test examples are around here, it's totally fine, right? But if many test examples are around here, what's the consequence? Yeah, it will make a lot of prediction mistakes, right? Similarly, for the other side, because H2 crossed high density region, so the test example will very much likely appear in both sides of the classification boundary, right? So if there are many test examples appear here, H2 will make a lot of mistakes. everyone feel comfortable about this one? Right? So now you can see what's the effect, or what's the side effect of the small margin, right? And now we can check what's the effect for large margin. So because each one has a much larger margin, right? So it is quite far away from the high density region. So what's the benefit? Yeah, because it is quite far away from the high density region. So it's unlikely to appear some oscillating effect, right? So it is very unlikely some negative examples will appear here, right? To cause each one to make prediction mistake on negative examples. It is very unlikely that there will be some positive testing examples appear here, right? So that each one will make some mistake. So that's the benefit for large margin classifier. So the farther your hyperplane from the data points, the farther your hyperplane is from the high density region, then the more mistakes you will avoid in the future prediction. So now we can say why we prefer large margin linear classifier, right? So this is just a kind of intuitive and qualitative analysis. And later in our lectures about computational learning theory, we'll give rigorous mathematical characterization. And you can see how margin it takes effect in the generalization bound of your linear classifier. So now comes our margin perception. So how does margin perception guarantees our learned linear classifier has a relatively large margin? So different from the standard perception that we update our weak vector when our prediction is correct is wrong, right? So the margin perception would pick up a positive threshold eta. And whenever this inequality holds, we update the weak vector. So this inequality is that yi times w transpose xi divided by the norm of w. When this value is less than eta, then we update the weak vector immediately following the same rule. So remember, even this inequality holds, our current prediction will be still correct. Because the numerator value could be positive, right? When the numerator value is positive, then our prediction on xi is correct. But even our prediction is correct, if this value is less than eta, we'll update the vector immediately. We'll say this condition is that the prediction is close to being incorrect. We'll update the perception. And we can prove that this margin perception can have a better generalization performance. But now comes the question, why updating according to this condition is a good idea? What can you observe from this condition?
It's pushing your margin further. It's saying, oh, if my margin's close here, I want to move my generalization boundary further away from it so that I have better margin on that point.
Yeah, exactly. Right. So we can say, what's the definition of the lag concept? It's the distance, right? So when our algorithm converges, that means we do not make such kind of mistakes, right? We do not violate this condition. So that means for any data points, this distance will be no less than eta, right? So remember, the definition for margin is the minimum distance, right? So it means that when our algorithm stops, the learned classifier's margin will be no less than eta. So actually, setting eta is equal to setting a lower bound of the margin. So if you set up a relatively big eta, you can guarantee the learned linear classifier will have a relatively large margin, right? That's the idea. And actually, we can prove under some restrictions, your eta cannot be extremely large. It has an upper limit. The algorithm will converge, and number of mistakes also has another bound. But we do not have time to prove this one. Yeah. So now let us look at a more practical scenario where our data is not linearly separable. So both the standard perception and the margin perception assume the data is linearly separable, right? So now what if our data is not linearly separable? It is quite common in real world applications. Then what hyperplane would you like to choose? You would like to use some hyperplane which can correctly classify most of the training examples, right? And we believe the prediction from such hyperplane is more robust, right? And we would like also to take into account all possible other linear classifiers. Say some linear classifier could correctly classify the hard examples, but at the cost of mistakenly predict other examples. Now how can we take into account all possible linear classifiers? So there comes the voting perception. So here's the idea for voting perception. So voting perception just track all the distinct lead vectors in our learning procedure. So as long in our standard perception learning phase, every time we'll update our lead vector, we come a new distinct lead vector, right? Then we store this new lead vector. At the same time, we track the number of examples which are correctly classified by this lead vector. So finally, we will not return the final lead vector. We'll return a list of distinct lead vectors which appear in our learning procedure. And also we report the number of examples which are correctly classified by this lead vector. Now we have a set of distinct lead vectors, right? And how can we use them for prediction? It's very simple, it's just like voting. So we use each distinct lead vector to give a prediction, right? Following the standard classification function, right? And then each prediction will have a valid. It is a count of using this lead vector to correctly classify the training examples, right? And now we count the votes for all the predictions, and we pick up the most voted prediction. So in this way, we take into account the prediction result for all distinct lead vectors in our perceptual learning, right? And for some classifier, as we just mentioned, it can correctly classify most of the training examples, then the count will be much larger, right? It means that it will have a much more influence on the final result, right? And also, we also consider the classifier which is not able to classify most of training examples, but able to classify some hard examples. We also take into account this lead vector, right? But the corresponding weight, the corresponding count, will be much smaller, right? Remember, the count is determined by the number of correctly classified examples. And in this way, we integrate the prediction result from all the distinct lead vectors. Then we get their votes to obtain our final prediction. So this is called voting perception.
Mm-hmm. So here you're keeping all the W that we find during the training or algorithm?
Yeah, that's a very good question. So although this method looks promising, it has a severe problem. Because you have to track all distinct lead vectors appearing in our learning procedure, right? If your data is extremely large, then your memory could be exploded, right? Then how can we still take into account all the effects of distinct lead vectors, but we do not want to store so much lead vectors explicitly? How can we do that?
Also, probably those first wave vectors that we get are pretty wrong, right? So look.
Yeah, you're saying pretty wrong, but this incorrectness are corrected by the weight, the count, right? So if the weight vector can correctly classify most of the examples, then the corresponding count is much larger, right? So it takes the most importance in our final prediction. So there comes a more practical solution, it's called average prediction. So average perception can also take into account all possible distinct lead vectors, but without saving all distinct lead vectors. How can we do that? We just keep an average lead vector, also initialized with zero. But in our learning procedure, whenever we process one training example, no matter whether our prediction is correct or not, we just add the current lead vector into the average lead vector. And finally, we return the average lead vector and use this average lead vector to predict each training example x. So how does this average lead vector take into account all existing lead vectors in our learning procedure? We can analyze, right? So suppose in our learning procedure we actually have a k distinct lead vectors, right? And the count for the k distinct vectors is c1 to ck. So remember, every time when we process one input vector, no matter we make a mistake or not, we'll add this current lead vector into our average lead vector. So the average lead vector is actually equals to the summation of c1 plus c1w1 plus c2w2 to ckwk. So you can see all distinct lead vectors are integrated into the average lead vector, and also their counts are integrated into that. So for linear class, for some ways which can classify most of the training examples, they have a much larger counts, right? So they have a larger influence on the average lead vector. And for other ones which have many missed predictions, then their count is much smaller, so they have less influence on average lead vector, right? And finally, we use this average lead vector to do the prediction. During the prediction, all the influence of the distinct lead vectors are integrated, right? Are expected from the final prediction result. And as we can see, because during the learning procedure, we only need to keep one average lead vector. We do not to track all distinct lead vectors. So our memory usage is much, much more efficient, right? So in practice, if you would like to choose perception as your tool to address your problem, you try to use average perception. So I think we should stop here. And there is one actual slide, and I help you, I remind you some subtle difference between the average perception and voltage perception. I hope you can take a look after class.